Good afternoon. My name is Jesse Arnold, head of marketing at Robson Forensic, and thank you for joining us for another episode of the Robson Forensic webinar series, where our in-house experts take a deeper dive into the science and standards behind much of our casework. As an attendee, you'll notice that your cameras are turned off and your microphones are muted. If you have questions or comments throughout the program, please email those to inquiries@robsonforensic.com. We'll be fielding questions at the end of the program, and it's unlikely that we'll have time to get to all of the questions that come in. We will, however, take the time to work through those questions after the program and get back to you as soon as we can and our schedule permits. So please don't hesitate to send in any questions that you have along the way. Before we get started on today's program, I just wanted to highlight that this presentation and the corresponding slides are copyrighted by Robson Forensic and may not be recorded, copied, distributed, or otherwise used without authorization. That being said, if you feel that the information you see today would be helpful for others in your firm or your local organization, reach out to us, because in many instances, we're able to accommodate requests for smaller presentations, and we can typically do so at no cost. So the same email address that we mentioned earlier, inquiries@robsonforensic.com. Send the information and we'll get back to you as soon as we can. So on to the program that we have for you today. This is a topic that I was really excited about when we got into the planning phase, because the situation we all find ourselves in today with social distancing and travel restrictions has made it incredibly difficult to logistically schedule site inspections with our forensic experts. So what we're hoping to do today is give you a primer on photogrammetry. And then we have two experts, two other experts, I should say, who are going to come on and give you practical advice on how to take better inspection photography that's suitable for future forensic analysis. The first of our speakers today is Steve Becker. Steve, I'm going to stop sharing my screen and let you take this over. And Steve, your background in photogrammetry is an interesting one. You've got your degree in mechanical engineering. You went on, you got your MBA from Syracuse. But you've worked for companies like Chrysler and Magna Powertrain. Can you tell us where you've developed this photogrammetry expertise that you can share with us today?
Sure. Thanks, Jesse. Basically, since high school and college, back when I was doing photography for high school, and then in college, we had a project where we were working on a delta wing aircraft development, and we had to do a flow visualization in a water tunnel. The only way to do that, of course, is with photogrammetry. So basing that on my background in physics and photographs, I thought cameras were just another sensor or test instrument. So then in the automotive industry, whether we were doing over-the-road vehicle testing or various forms of industrial testing where we had surveillance cameras in test cells or on vehicles, I would use that data for making my measurements and determining what's going on with the test equipment. As well, we implemented these things in production to make certain that we had all of the parts in place or that they were in the right specification and positioning. So I've been using that now in the forensic field for over 10 years now. And page down, there we go, just delayed. So I wanted to go over today some of what I call digital forensics. We're gonna really hit more of the analysis and presentation information, not so much on the identification and preservation. I'm gonna leave that up to your attorneys, adjusters, and et cetera to find these home surveillance cameras, the industrial surveillance cameras, cell phone data, onboard vehicle cameras, et cetera. They're just ubiquitous, just about everywhere out there. In the analysis, we're gonna look at some tidbits of whether the image is real or altered, some of the enhancement techniques and methods we can do, speed analysis, which is often important for vehicles and people, how they move through a scene and general measurements, and then color, which oftentimes gets also applied to identifying a vehicle make or model or other location object. So digital imagery, it all starts with pixels, basically. Pixels are another term for picture element, and they're a pile of square dots all arranged in a grid on your screen and in your camera sensor. On the left here, we have an image zoomed in that shows several of the pixels. Each one contains the information related to any given point in your camera. They're standardized by height and width. But the same thing applies to videos. So videos are, of course, moving pictures. So in other words, it's a number of still images stacked up on top of each other per second that gives us the perception of motion. And the human eye sees things at about 15 frames or images cycling in front of us per second. So most quality video is going to be about 30 frames per second. And then when you go faster than that, you can slow down the video or use what's called slow motion. And if you're lower than that, and in many cases that's used in surveillance systems, you get more of a stop motion. So it's a little bit staggered. And some of the key factors for digital image quality is going to be in a specific camera sensor. Take one camera, like my computer monitor camera here versus my digital camera for taking images, and you get drastically different qualities. So the camera's optics and sensor are really key, as well as, of course, the lighting conditions, the direction and quality of the light. And then the camera settings drastically affect the light settings or how bright or dark in any given image is. If you have an expert out there that's telling you, you know, this is how dark or how bright it was in the scene based on this image they're showing on a screen, well, that'll change depending on the screen you're looking at, the lighting conditions, and just small changes in angle even of the camera. For example, right now, I appear fairly bright on my screen. If I turn on this lamp behind me, I'm still fairly bright. But as I change the angle, now suddenly I'm dark. But if you were in this room with me, I would still appear just as bright as I did before. So really it comes down to how the camera is capturing that light. And then other factors such as the size, you know, of course, more pixels, more detail, and then the file format. Some files use what's called a lossy format to make the files smaller and compress them. One of the factors we have to account for is lens distortion. And this is specifically mostly for making the measurements. What you see in the upper left here is your a fairly gross example of a fisheye lens where you have drastic differences in the vertical versus lateral distances measured. And down below, you have an architectural example where the post-processing analysis tilted the building upward. The original image is up above and the altered image is below, where it made the building look more square relative to the camera. But what we're typically doing in these two images on in the center of the screen with the grids is trying to take out the distortion that you see primarily in the corners. So all lenses have a bit of a convex shape, and we correct for that if we can tell what camera was used or if we use a calibrated camera. So again, back to pixels, each one of those pixels has to be identified digitally. So we can't store, you know, blue. We just store the numbers of colors of red, green, or blue, RGB, to determine the given color of any given object. On the left here, you see a color palette and color wheel. And what you see is that the red, green, and blue values are all drastically different, but they're both in the green realm. So what was happening here is this is one image taken by two different cameras in two different lighting conditions of the exact same green box. So the color splotch down below is a sample of the color from that digital image. And that's going to be regardless of the color you see on your screen or whether you print it out in your printer, et cetera. And then both of them track that it's green, but two different, significantly different colors of green. Kind of like the pop icon of this blue dress where people were wondering if it was blue or white, et cetera. Well, to solve all that question. It's actually a blue dress. Just digitally, you can make it look lighter and whiter depending on the exposure inside the digital image settings. So now again, digital images can have artifacts on them. So in other words, over on the right, you see an image that was grossly affected by EMF, electromagnetic. Down in the bottom, you see an image with a vehicle, and that is a whole solid normal vehicle, but it was moving through that scene and that surveillance system wasn't storing all the information properly in each frame. And what you got is a splotchy vehicle. Another thing I tell you not to do though, try not to get videos by capturing them with your cell phone or other camera by taking images of a screen. It works just to, you know, document you were there, but for any further analysis, a lot of times you're off angle for the image taking a picture of the screen, or the screen has defects. If you look down near like sort of the blue button, you can see that there's a distortion in the screen rays. And the same thing happens if you look like in my phone. Instead of seeing me, you're seeing my phone. Now, the phone case is all black, but you see these white lines? Those are halos from the white light. And that's just an artifact of digital image storage, not an alteration of the image itself. So again, things we're looking for are consistencies in light. Over in the upper right, we have a house listing, and the realtor thought it would look better with a few features altered. As a digital expert, we can identify those features based on the differences in lighting. If you look over behind the tree, you'll see the shadowing is different than compared to the shadowing relative to the windows. We're also going to look at edge analysis, and that's going to tell us when something's been inserted into the image, like when they wiped out the entire background with this blue sky. So lighting is a key characteristic, telling us whether something's photoshopped or not. Through water, you'll see reflections that come in differently, because all images are just a matter of how the light makes it into the camera. In the lower left image, we have a picture of a car through a windshield, a very dirty windshield. But in that car, we're never going to pick out that license plate. That's just not something we're going to be able to see because it's in the shadow of the car. And I know it's in the shadow of the car because the light rays are all consistent with the direction of light and the shading on the car relative to the camera. Other things we look for in image alteration is whether it has the proper metadata. Some of this can be turned off, but typically it'll tell you the camera used, the model of the camera, some of the photography settings, the f-stop, exposure, and ISO, focal length for allowing us to do better measurements, etc. And occasionally, depending on the camera or the person, you can turn these things off. You get the latitude and longitude, or the position in which the camera was located when it took the image. It doesn't tell you the orientation, just where. Without that information, if you store your images as a PDF or you copy and paste them somewhere else and pull them into some other program, etc., photocopy them, that wipes all that information out. And that may be fine if that's what you want to send to the other side of the case, but don't do that to your own expert. If you can, we would really like to get what we call the native file, and that applies to both videos and images. And that allows us to do that sort of error level analysis as well as the metadata evaluation. So in video forensics, you have a key characteristic of where the camera's pointed. I don't know why, but every analysis I seem to do has the camera pointed in one place and the object of interest is nowhere near where that camera is pointed. In this screen, you can see that the key characteristics and things that they wanted to capture were this door and these other doors, but they've got all this extra space on the left and you can barely see this vehicle moving by out front. Another feature we're going to look at is the timestamp and that consistency with movement, motion, and light tracking in the video. And then you'll still have things like motion blur and et cetera so we can still, you know, zoom in and see what's going on and determine distances and speeds. You know, like in this example, if we knew the size of those doors and the amount of time that it took for the vehicle to move from one window to another, we can track that vehicle's speed given time and distance. What we can't do, and we call this the CSI effect. A lot of people expect and have seen in TV and movies all this super digital enhancement where suddenly now you can see miraculously this guy's face from a camera 1,000 feet away. In reality, what we can do is zoom in. The resolution is going to be the resolution. We can't create new information. But we can alter the brightness and adjust the image. What you see in the upper section is the same image. It has these color squares in it that allowed us to calibrate and pull out. And then now you can miraculously see the person instead of just sort of this black blob. In the lower image, we can demonstrate video tracking of movement and position, provide enhancements to draw your attention to one position or another. And of course, zoom in and crop and things like that. So when we're doing speed and analysis, we'll do speed analysis either directly in the image by using, as I said, a known distance and time of travel, sometimes compared to Google Earth or site inspections, or we'll convert that and create a 3D sort of simulation or map. And we'll measure the time and distance. So if you have things like skid marks on the roadway, we can, if the images are of quality and there's reference points of known dimensions in there, we can determine the distance traveled or the distance skid by the vehicle or person. And again, one of the things we'll like to do if we can to get the best measurements would be to go out and do a 3D digital scan. With that 3D digital scan, we can then match, you know, unknown camera images and then create a 3D world that we can then overlay the two and match up any given geometry component. Or we can do, as I said, direct comparison, where if you have a known door height, you determine where the feet are on the floor relative to the door, and then you can determine a person's position or height or what they have on them. This is an example where we had limited information to make measurements on. So we did a 3D scan of this site and it had this hump and an ATV went by and flipped. So how do you determine the speed from that? Well, the way we did that was through using that 3D laser scan and then creating an animation relative to the video. And I have that video here. If it will play. There we go. So a pretty simple video, and we weren't really concerned with what happened after the flip. Did that share work properly, Jesse?
I believe it did. Yeah, I just had my microphone muted because my dog doesn't think we should be quiet right now.
Don't they always?
They do.
Mine are actually being gems. So anytime you do photogrammetry, you're going to have a rate of error that your expert should be aware of and know how to calculate. You'll have potential scanner error, pixel rate error, and all of this is going to be a relationship to the distance from the camera. This is just an example, but you know, I've done some that are actually about 1,000 feet away from the camera, and others, of course, you know, within a few 10 feet of the camera. And those error rates all change depending on what you're doing and the quality of the information you're presenting. When it comes to a little bit more specialized information, like vehicle identification, kind of the gold standard everybody's looking for is license plate ID. I can tell you up front that most, you know, home surveillance cameras aren't going to be picking up license plates because the systems that do capture license plates on high-speed moving vehicles are designed, angled, and set up for doing that. So it is possible on some generic cameras. It's just you got to have pretty good view of the plate. Other things we'll do is look for key characteristics. We'll make measurements of the wheelbase or the angles of the A pillar and C pillar, front and rear of the vehicle, looking for characteristics like trim or logos and ID plates, and then a variety of other vehicle proportions. Here's another example of some of the things we do. On the left, you have this woman who was walking out of a doorway, tripped and fell. And the concern was, did she trip and fall on a carpet that was quite a ways out of the doorway, or did she trip and fall someplace else? And what we're able to do is zoom in, freeze down the video to the point of identifying where she started her trip and fall and land. And you can see basically she'd tripped right in the threshold. In this other one, we had the police where they were concerned about an object in this person's hand. I showed it was actually a thumb. So it wasn't a thing in the hand, it was part of the hand. The last thing I want to leave you with is, you know, just making certain that your expert has the qualifications to do what we're discussing as far as videogrammetry and photo analysis. This science is not new and novel. We have SAE papers and other varieties of published works. So these procedures have been tested and shown to be proper. And then, as I discussed, you have a known error rate and it's been accepted in the community. And with that, I'm gonna pass that back to Jesse.
Marcus, I see your camera turned on, which is great. You can go ahead and share your screen. Tony talked to us about documenting the built environment and his approach in that, and to provide a different perspective on this, we wanted to have Marcus from our automotive practice come in and talk about some of the techniques that are relevant to documenting a crashed vehicle, or the same tactics he's going to discuss could also be applied to a piece of machinery or something like that. Now, Marcus, you also have an interesting background. Education-wise, you did your undergrad at Lehigh, you went on, you got your master's of engineering at the University of Michigan, and then you worked for Daimler Chrysler. You did some vehicle development and testing for the Department of Defense, and you even went on and owned your own custom tuning shop for a little bit. Can you tell us a little bit about your background and your forensic experience that you're leaning on today in your presentation?
Sure, absolutely. Thank you, Jesse. As Jesse mentioned, I have nearly 20 years of experience as a mechanical engineer, and much of that experience was in the automotive engineering sector, including at OEMs, tier one suppliers, and of course, the Department of Defense. I do lean on much of that experience in my casework, which includes crash reconstruction, automotive repair claims. I do have a background in motorsports and again, any automotive product type cases. Some of the more interesting cases we're seeing a lot of interest in lately are cases involving ADAS or advanced driver assistance systems. These include for collision warning, autonomous emergency braking, lane departure warning. So there are a lot of cases now involving these systems as they become more prevalent in vehicles. I also see a lot of side-by-side or UTV cases as these vehicles become more popular. And we're seeing that many of these vehicles lack rollover or proper rollover protection, including the structure of the roll cage itself. And then, of course, photogrammetry and video analysis, which is what we're here to discuss today. So today I want to discuss vehicle photo documentation. And as Jesse mentioned, much of this can be transferred to any piece of machinery, really. In crash reconstruction, the incident vehicles themselves can provide a lot of critical information that we require to reconstruct the crash or some other incident. Photos are obviously a very important part of documenting a visual inspection and can provide much of the information that we require during our analysis. Of course, some important aspects that we need to capture with photos would be the nature, extent, and location of the crash or incident damage. Obviously, an overview of the entire vehicle, including the interior, exterior, and underhood, the vehicle structure, Seatbelts and airbags can tell us a lot about a vehicle. Wheels and tires, the light bulbs, and of course, identifying information, which would include the VIN number along with other types of information. Some of the most common issues I see with vehicle photographs that I receive either from attorneys or from other experts. This is a list that I see quite commonly. Zoomed in or close in photos of the vehicle damage only. This can pose an issue because there's no reference to the rest of the vehicle to give us an idea of the size, location, or orientation of that damage. Going hand in hand with that is the lack of objects that can be used for scaling. As Anthony mentioned, we don't need necessarily a ruler. Any sort of common object can be used to assist us in scaling. However, rulers would be the most beneficial. We see a lot of photos taken at irregular angles, insufficient quantity of photos. Today, memory is quite inexpensive. Most cell phones and other cameras can take thousands of photos very easily given the memory cards we have available. So there shouldn't be any reason for only taking two or three photos when obviously more photos can be more beneficial to us. Varying focal lengths. This isn't something that we see as a major issue with cell phones. Obviously, most cell phones have a fixed focal length, but other types of cameras, people tend to zoom in and out quite a bit. Much of our photogrammetry software works better if we keep a standard or constant focal length. We do see, as Tony also mentioned, blurry photos. Photos of low resolution, black and white photos. Believe it or not, there is considerable information to be gained from the color if we're trying to identify a type of fluid or other types of features. Oftentimes, colors can provide valuable information in that process. And then oftentimes, we also get photocopies of photos, which creates a large loss of resolution, and we also lose a lot of metadata and other types of data that are stored with a digital original photograph. So what is contained or what do we do to properly document a vehicle with photos? I have a minimum standard photo set that I use for every vehicle, regardless of the damage or the incident type. So we don't want to put the blinders on and just go right for the damaged area. There's a lot of information on the vehicle outside of that damaged area that can provide a lot of valuable information. So in my standard portfolio, and I will go through each one of these in more detail, I have a slide for each of these, but we have our 360 degree shots. Again, interior, underhood, and exterior shots are very important. And then features such as the seatbelts and airbags, wheels and tires, light bulbs, and other identifying information provide a lot of information for us in our reconstruction analysis. Before we get into each one of those in my standard photo set, I do want to go over a few photo documentation tips. Tony touched on this as well, that most photos should be taken normal to the plane of interest. So what I mean by this is straight on versus at an angle. And this is especially important if we're using a scale. Again, that way we can read the scale and properly determine the measurement from the scale and the object it's referring to. Oftentimes there are reasons to take a photograph at an angle. Scratches and other blemishes may show up better when photographed at an angle, and also altered lighting. So flash versus no flash or using a flashlight oftentimes can help bring out some of the detail of scratches and other blemishes. Again, take lots of photos. There's really no excuse for not taking a considerable number of photos given the lack of memory limitations that most cameras and cell phones have. I typically, in a photo set, I'll have generally 300 plus photos for a vehicle from a typical inspection. Depending on the severity of the damage and type, it may go upwards of 400 or 500 photos. Many cell phones take great macro shots. Macro shots are very close zoomed in shots that can provide detail. I oftentimes also use my cell phone on top of my SLR camera because of how great the macro capabilities of the phones are these days. Another tip that I use is a selfie stick, believe it or not. I combine my cell phone with a selfie stick. And I can take photos of hard to reach places such as the underbody of the vehicle, the bumper beam, suspension shots that are behind the wheel and tire. Also useful for taking top-down shots. So if I'm interested in viewing the car from a top view, this is another great tip. And then my last tip is, and you're gonna see this theme throughout the rest of my slide deck, is take broad shots first before getting close in. When we have a close in or a zoomed in shot, oftentimes it's difficult to tell what the shot is a close up of. So if we take a broad shot first and keep the shots in sequence, we can use that progression of photos to identify what the zoomed in shots are of and where they're located. So with that, I'm gonna get into a subset of my typical photo documentation regimen for a vehicle. Again, I start with 360 degree photos. These are some of the most important photos that we'll take of a vehicle. And again, it's basically taking photos of the front, front corner, side, rear, rear corner, corners of the vehicle. And I do this, I generally like to do a minimum of 8 shots, and I like to do this at 2 different heights. So generally crouching down at 2 to 3 feet and then standing at a height of 5 to 6 feet. And again, these shots are important. We can use these for various analyses, but it also gives us a great reference of the vehicle overall. Interior shots, I like to take shots of the interior looking through each door. Obviously shots of the dash with the ignition on to get odometer readings and to visualize any other codes or error messages that may be present. Photos of the footwell, especially in unintended acceleration cases, allows us to look at floor mat positioning, the pedals, and if there are any other issues. And I like to document the rest of the dash as well to indicate if there, what switches have been on or off and where the position of the shift lever may be. Underhood, again, you can see the theme here. I start out with broad shots of the entire underhood and then close-in shots. I like to document fluid levels in photographs, the condition of the battery and fuses. This can help determine whether or not any repairs are needed or anything needs to be done if we're going to download black box data. Exterior shots. This is when we start looking a little closer at the damage itself. Again, the theme here is start out broad. And then as we go across the top photos from left to right, we continually get closer until we can see the white scuff mark in the top right photo. Again, oftentimes the top right photo is the only photo I receive. And although I can see the scuff mark clearly, I really have no idea what the position or orientation of that scuff mark is relative to the vehicle. So this is why it's critical to start broad, move in, and keep the shots in sequence. Below, I took the shots of that same scuff at different angles to see if that would help bring out any more detail in the scuff. And then lower center is a straight-on photo with a scale, which allows us to clearly determine the height of that scuff mark. Obviously, another shot would accompany this showing the end of the tape measure as to where I took the measurement from. Seatbelt photos and airbag photos are important. Which airbags fired and whether they fired can give us an indication of crash severity. Looking at the seatbelt, if the seatbelt is taut up against the B-pillar and the airbags fired, that can give us an indication to whether or not the belt was worn. In that case, it would not have been worn. And close-up shots of the various components, the D-ring in the upper right, the latch plate and the two lower photos and the buckle, all of these can show signs of whether or not the belt was loaded and can indicate whether or not the belt was in use. Things like striations, any sort of melting or any other types of things that we can see can give us that indication. Wheels and tires, where the rubber meets the road. These are often overlooked. People often forget that there could have been a tire defect prior to the collision that may have been causative to the collision. Just because a tire is flat doesn't mean the flat tire was caused by the collision. It could have been prior to the collision. And there are signs that we can see on the tire that can indicate that. So again, I start with a broad shot in the top left. I take shots of the tread. In the center right is a slightly closer shot, and then close-up shots of the entire sidewall going around. There's a lot of information on the sidewall of a tire, including DOT numbers, size of the tire, and of course we look at any damage to the sidewall to indicate condition of the tire prior to a collision. Light bulbs can also be important. We can determine a lot by looking at a light bulb. Things such as hot shock, where the filament may stretch or twist if the bulb is illuminated during impact forces. And if a bulb is broken, there are other signs that we can look at, such as oxidation. So documenting, again, broad view of the bulbs so that we know which bulbs we're looking at and where they are located in the vehicle, and then zooming in or taking close-in shots to see the detail of the filament, again, are important in doing those types of analyses. And then lastly, and very importantly, is identifying information. Things such as the VIN number. Every vehicle has a VIN number located at the base on the driver's side of the windshield. This allows us to identify the vehicle and ensure it is the vehicle in question. But it also allows us to look up the vehicle and find more information from the manufacturer for that specific vehicle. Center bottom is the build sticker. Again, lots of important information. Top center is the Tread Act sticker. These two stickers are generally located inside the driver door near the latch plate and provide a lot of information for us. On the right, this is specific to Pennsylvania. Certain states have state required inspections. PA requires both a safety and emissions inspection annually. Many people take photos of the outside of the sticker, however, neglect to take photos of the inside. There's lots of valuable information on the inside of the sticker, including the odometer reading, the inspection station, the inspector, and which wheels were removed during that inspection. So basically, if there's a sticker on the vehicle with any sort of information printed on it, that is something that I document as part of my process. So this is just a quick overview. Obviously, there'd be considerably more photos in a standard set, but I think this gives a pretty good overview of how to properly document a vehicle. And again, as Jesse said, this would be applicable to any type of machine, really. So with that, I'll hand it back over to Jesse.
Marcus, I was just saying thank you. Thank you again for taking the time to be with us today. We did have a number of questions coming in. And Marcus, one of the questions that I had for you, we had a few people who commented on the relative lack of damage on that vehicle you were photographing. Now, I know that's your mother-in-law's CRV, and you were just using that for demonstration purposes. But if you had a vehicle with substantial damage to it, are there any tips for the people out there on how to capture the scale of the damage or the crush, I believe is the word that you guys use to describe that?
Yeah, depending on the severity of the damage, we can do photogrammetry and create either a 3D or a 2D perimeter of that damage in CAD using photogrammetry techniques. The best photos we use for that are generally the 360 degree shots. If they're taken properly at a few different heights and again at a constant focal length, they generally are the best photos that we can use when determining that. Obviously some closer in photos at different angles or from different elevations can help. But again, we need enough reference in each photo in order to stitch them together during that process. So again, the 360 shots that show more of the vehicle and are taken at a constant focal length tend to be the best photos that we can use for that process.
Got it. Great to know. Thank you, Marcus. And we are, we're at the end of our time, but Steve, I think we've got time for one more question for you. We've had a number come in, but one of the questions we saw repeated here is involving the speed measurements that you're able to make from different kinds of video recordings. And there's potentially intersection cameras, ATM cameras, security cameras. Do you have advice for the people listening in today on how to request that video data in a way that you're most likely to preserve the quality of the video?
Yeah, that tends to be a bit of a tricky subject, because oftentimes the people on that scene aren't the owners of that camera, if it's a business, et cetera. So then you need to get in touch with the owner or the manager. More commonly though, it's through the police. The police can obtain those types of information relative to a given case. The difficulty really comes in is that these things are stored on systems that have a rolling buffer. So in other words, it's overwriting data at some regular interval of time. And if you don't get into the case early enough, the data is just gone. Luckily nowadays, hard drives are getting bigger. So if the system's slightly newer rather than, you know, 2005 or something like that, you have a better chance of it. But it really depends on your timing and who you can contact.
Got it. So best advice is to go after it sooner rather than later, I suppose. Unfortunately, that's really all the time that we have today. If we didn't get to your question, we will work through it and get back to you as soon as we can. If you have additional questions, as you think about it later this afternoon, please feel free to send them in to inquiries@robsonforensic.com. We hope that you'll join us again in the coming weeks. Check out our upcoming programs at robsonforensic.com/webinars. You can see the upcoming programs and the registration pages for each. Again, my name is Jesse Arnold. We appreciate you joining us here today. Have a great day, and we'll talk to you soon.